So, welcome to yet another course in the JavaScript track. So, you're not that many today, and that's because I think we've lost half the crowd from the last course to this course. I think that you who are here are mainly software technology, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So we lost the network security folks. So this course, first of all of you in here took the last course, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. And if we have any joining from Kalmar or somewhere else taking this course, please let us know in the chat if you didn't read the preceding course, the one DV525, because it would be great to know, since we could have kind of a different setup depending on which students taking the course. So there has been some confusion about this course, and that's mainly because somewhere in the administration, someone said that this course was a Kalmar course and not a Växjö course. So when applying to this course, you just had to ignore the fact that it says Kalmar and not Växjö. But on the other hand, that meant that some of students in Kalmar applied for this course as well, with the intention or thought that this would be a Kalmar course, which it's not. It's a Växjö course. So we have decided to kind of give this course in a flexible manner. We kind of did that with the last course as well, because some of the tutoring was done over Skype, and we had some examinations done over Skype. So we will continue in the same fashion in this course. But the main thing might be that not all lectures are going to be held here in Växjö. We will try some or experiment with the lectures in a way that I will get back to. So if we have students that don't know who I am, my name is Johan Leitet, and I am the course coordinator or program coordinator for the Kalmar-based program in web development. And this course, server-based web programming, is a part of that program. The preceding course, 1DV525, was more or less the same as a course that we give in the program. Just the beginning, the first part in that course wasn't the same. But it's in this course, everything is exactly the same. So students in Kalmar will take this course the next semester after Christmas, and you will get it now. So those of you who noticed that the last course was only 9 weeks, because we have this kind of stupid 9+11 system, this course will be 11 weeks, and the students in Kalmar will get this course on 9 weeks the next semester. So you will probably find that the speed of this course is a little bit slower, or the pace is a little bit slower than the preceding one. Okay, let's dive into it. First of all, the man in front, John. John usually sits in Kalmar, as you know, when we have lectures and control everything. Today he's here, and that's because he's the course manager of this course. So even though I'm standing here speaking to you, John is the guy to contact with administrative stuff, like I want to register on the course, or is my prerequisites enough, and things like that. Contact John if the schedule is a mess or whatever. I'm a course instructor, so I will have this lecture, and probably the following lectures I will be a part of together with John. So we will do some kind of co-op on those lectures. And because it's a Kalmar course and not a Växjö course, if you have registration issues, problem registering on the course or whatever, please contact our administrator in Kalmar, Katrin Bramhag Svensson, instead of Eva, because she handles this course. So you have her email here if you like to contact her. Or go through Jan, and he will direct you forward. Well, yeah, it's only us, right? Because Mats and Jacob that you met in the last course, they will not be involved because you are not more than 16 or 17 students, so we will manage. So, the syllabus. The main field of study of this course is computer science. It's on the progression G1F, so it has some prerequisites. The prerequisites of this course is either you have the preceding course, the 1DV525. You don't need to be have completed that course, but we will look that you must have at least done some kind of JavaScript part in that course, like the second assignment, because we will hit it off with JavaScript right off the bat. So there is no time to learn JavaScript in this course. If you don't have that course, it's okay to have the 1DV022 from Calmer together with a course about HTML and CSS. But you need a client-side course, and you need some kind of HTML CSS, the equivalent of what you got in the 1DV525. I think this syllabus is in Swedish, but you would probably, if you would like to read it, it's supposed to be in English somewhere as well. Maybe on the course webpage, actually, if you visit the webpage. Yeah. So we will go through the goals of the course, what we are supposed to do. So first of all, the last course we were focusing entirely on the client, more or less. We had written some server applications that you could use, like the quiz application or the chat socket application. In this course, we are doing the opposite. So in this course, you are focusing on the server components, and the client is just something that you might need to implement to get a result. But we will not focus on the client. We will focus entirely on the server and on the server communicating with the client. So first goal: describe the task of the web server in different kinds of web applications. So we will actually start today by discussing web servers, and we will see that Node, that is the platform we will use in this course, is vastly different from other types of web servers like Apache. You will be able to describe the purpose of the HTTP protocol in different kind of web applications and its pros and cons in this context. So we will focus quite a lot on the HTTP protocol. We introduced it in the last course, but we will dive much deeper into the HTTP protocol in this course because it's that important when it comes to writing server-side applications. Diving into the HTTP protocol is not specific to Node, which is the platform we use in this course. It could apply to other web services or web application platforms as well. But we will specifically create web applications with the platform Node.js. So, and that's mainly because Node.js is quite a neat platform when it comes to real-time web applications and handling a lot of requests. And we write the code in JavaScript, which is quite nice. We have JavaScript full stack with a client going to the server and even adding data in JSON formats in databases or transmitting data using JSON. We will create web applications for handling persistent data, where data can be saved, updated, and deleted. So a classical CRUD application, create, update, delete application. We will have a look at that as well. That's the classic web. When you think of classic server-side web applications, you probably will think about CRUD applications. We will also look at handling persistent data. So we will look at database, look at the server saving data in a database, not a SQL Server database. Have you all taken some kind of database theory course or something like that? You're doing it now with Morgan, okay. Yeah, so he will probably discuss different kinds of databases that you have, SQL Server databases, you have document-oriented databases and such, and we will be focusing on document-oriented databases in this course. But we don't have any prerequisites of databases, so we will kind of get you into it as well. So it probably will fit quite well with Morgan's course, actually. Further, it's a lot of things to cover in this course as well. Describe and have a practical understanding of different security problems that can occur in web applications, and this is an important goal. And it's security in web applications, basically. I didn't say much about it in the client course because on the client we don't have security, more or less. We have a security model in the browser, but we can't do secure web applications using only the browser. We need a server in more or less every decision we make. So in this course, we will focus on security. We will create web applications with for the context suitable architecture. We will not it's not an architectural course, but we will discuss different design decisions when it comes to creating those kinds of applications. And we will create server-based real-time applications, and this one is, I mean, you've tried it in the client with a chat. It's kind of a real-time application, but we will dive even further in this course and see how to handle those types of applications. We will plan and perform publishing of web applications created for the Node.js platform in production environment, and this is also quite an important goal for the course, that we will not only create the applications and run them in our own local environment, we will also look of how to run them in a production environment. Okay, so we will not touch upon Docker and those kinds of things, but we will still look at how to set up some kind of production chain and using process managers for handling those applications, and even looking at Nginx maybe, yeah, for a front for our application. So I think this is something that is really important today. When I learned web programming, you kind of had some kind of FTP server where you dragged your files into the server and they were published on a web hotel somewhere. Today, that's not a suitable way of running applications. We have much better ways to do it, and we will have a look at that as well. But that's more or less the last piece of the course, so it will come in the end over Christmas or something like that. Okay, the approach to the course, it's divided into three parts. The first part starting today is about Node.js as a platform, about web service, the HTTP, and I will have a few words about ECMAScript 2015 as well. You have been quite introduced to those concepts already taking the preceding course. For those of you who did not take the preceding course, you need to read up on news in ECMAScript that might not have been introduced when you took the course. The preceding course. So that's the first part. The second part is the backend web applications, web security, and web architecture. And the third one is about real-time application and the publishing and production steps. The scheduled activities is those. We have 7 lectures, this one being the first. As I said in the beginning, maybe not all lectures will be, or I can say that not all lectures will be held in this room, because we will try to not go to Växjö as frequently as we did last time, because we going here takes 5 hours of commuting basically for one day, and that's a lot of time wasted. So we will try to work in other ways in this course. And we have some ideas. I could hint, but it's not sure that we will go through with them. But we have some kind of thought that we will either record or live broadcast lectures where me and John are like sitting down and discussing the topics for the week. So it will be kind of a lecture, but we will both be having the lecture in a conversation. So we'll try that concept because I think it could be quite good for you, and we could have like opposite stance in some critical questions and such. If we get everything up and running, we might as well live stream them, and you can in the schedule when they are being broadcasted, and you can join us on live coding. We only have like 3 or 4 seconds delay on live coding, so if you are asking us questions, we will get them quite directly. And we will of course record them, so they will be recorded as well. We will, and many of you told me last week that you really enjoyed the peer instructions. And this course was basically from the beginning built upon peer instructions. So we have 3 peer instructions in the course, 1 for each part. And we will continue with that. I'm not sure how we are going to do the peer instructions. Probably it would be nice to go here for them, I guess, because the majority of you are here in Växjö, and Kalmar students could join us over live coding. We've done that with the in the Kalmar course last period, and I think it worked. And we are using Discord for discussion during the lecture. But we will get into more details about that soon. We have tutoring each week in the schedule. We will be doing that tutoring over Skype. And you will have, I think you there is a Connect room, Adobe Connect room, that you just enter and you write your name, and we will like contact you in order over Skype. I think that's the most efficient way of doing the tutoring sessions. And of course, if you have problems during the week, of course, just tell us in the Slack channel. There are 3 examination assignments. The first one is a hand-in assignment, so you will hand it in and we will have a look at it. So there is no oral hearing for the first assignment. However, the second and third assignments you have to do something like in the preceding course. You do a practical assignment and then you will have an oral hearing with theoretical questions together with a look at your application that you created. Do we know? Yeah. Yeah, it's for those of you who took the preceding course, it's this exactly the same kind of questions and more or less exactly the same. Maybe we will not go here for the examinations. Maybe we will have them over Skype because we can only do like 16 if we go here, and we can do like 22 or something if we stay in Kalmar. So depending on how many is taking the course. Yeah, so that's basically the approach to the course. The third assignment will be like the week after New Year or something like that. So the third assignment is an assignment that you could work with over the Christmas holidays. So you will probably have quite a lot of time with the third assignment compared to students taking this course next semester. So if you like a week off over Christmas, that will probably be fine in this course. And during the lectures, we have booked 1 room here in Kalmar, and that's the lobby over here, 1167. So that's more or less just an indication that if you like, you could all sit there or somewhere else, look at the lecture together if you like, and discuss stuff. If you don't like that approach, feel free to do whatever you like, but it will be live broadcasted on those occasions. The literature for the course is Eloquent JavaScript 2nd edition. That's the same book that we had in the preceding course. There are only 2 chapters handling Node.js, so we will refer to those. And we have this recommended book as well, Web Development with Node and Express by Ethan Brown. It's not a must-have book, but it's nice. It's a nice introduction to Express, which is the framework we will use when writing server-side applications. But we will provide you with a lot of online material as well to each and every lecture. And you will have to read up before the peer instructions in this course, because we will have peer instruction questions to the resources in the course. So please read up. Okay, so which tools are we going to use? So Git is a must. Git and GitHub. We will, everything, all code should go into your GitHub repositories. Those repositories will be generated on an organization, a course organization. So if you go to GitHub/ and the course code 1DV523, you will later this week get repositories for the assignments and exercises in the course, just like the preceding course. However, you will not get merge conflicts in this course because the README file will not be there. So it will be empty repositories. That's more or less the only mandatory resource we have. We recommend using JetBrains WebStorm, like in the last course. You are perfectly fine with whatever IDE you like. You can use Atom or Sublime or whatever.
When will the first deadline be?
It will be in 3 weeks or something like that.
Yeah,
4 weeks.
Yeah,
3 or 4 weeks, something like that. Yeah, we need to write that down because they can't see that in the schedule because we don't have an oral hearing. I will show you the course page soon, and the deadline will be there for that assignment. So use whatever editor you like. If you want to, you can use Vagrant and the VirtualBox to virtualize your application environment or developing environment. That's totally up to you. I think John has prepared a Vagrant machine with Node and all the tools needed installed, pre-installed, so you can use that Vagrant machine if you like. If you don't want to, you're free to do that as well. You can install everything on your local computer. You can install Node and MongoDB and those tools you need on your computer if you like. But I would recommend using Vagrant because you don't want to clutter your local machine with a lot of development tools. And yeah, Node.js, you will need Node.js, the platform, to be able to execute the code. And when installing Node.js, you will get the Node Packet Manager as well. But as I said, if you're using John's Vagrant machine, you will get those installed right off the box. Do you get the latest version of Node? Yeah. Great. And you can use the latest version of Node as well. There are one stable and one, what's it called? Remember? If we go to No. IBM. So they want to jump the train as well. This LTS version is probably recommended for production environment, but you could go with this one, the 7.0 that was just released this week, which should have quite good support for the newest ECMAScript standard as well. So that's about what tools you need. You need to be quite familiar with Git. So if you are not, please read up on Git. So the course webpage is this one. If you're registered on the course, you will find it at lnus.com/student, and you will get a direct link to the course webpage, hopefully. Looks something like this. You know the drill, more or less. You have this live stream you can watch here. You have the course syllabus. You have our or information about this one is false, but John will update that one. Reading list. This one was interesting. What is this? It's only about the literature of the course. And
If you didn't take the preceding course, please use this profile information tab to fill in your information about which GitHub ID you have. That's because we need that in order to be able to create repositories for you. So update your profile if it's not right. A lot of you asked about what program you take, and this one, PT, is software technology. So if you are a software technology student, use the PT prefix. That's the Swedish prefix, so that's why it says something like that. Or you can use some kind of none if you are a freestanding student. And yeah, so going into a lecture, this one, you will have all the resources to the lecture. The recording will be presented here, and to today's lecture we have a lot of demos as well, so you can have a look at those. And it will go on like this with a lecture, and then we will have a peer instruction, then three lectures, a peer instructions, two lectures, and a third peer instruction. So this is quite neat. You will not see those with ghosts yet, but you will soon. The first assignment, it's crossed over right now, but the assignment will be this one. So this is the assignment. Up here we'll probably... Oh, we have a deadline. Ah, okay. Yeah, you don't have until February to do this one. When this one is not grayed out, the exam assignment, you will find the correct deadline for the assignment here. And we will probably fix that quite soon. Yeah. So the first assignment will be the same as last year. The second assignment will be the same as last year. And the first one is basically creating a web scraper using Node. The second is some kind of crude application concerning code snippets. So a crude application, create, update, delete, handling some login, I think, as well. Quite a classic web application in the second one. And the third one will be a real-time application. Probably has to do something with using webhooks on GitHub and presenting data in some kind of way. But we'll get into that later on. So the third assignment, if you knew the course from last year, the third assignment is different. Okie doke. So on the course webpage, you will find everything static plus news. And of course, we're using Slack for all discussions in the course. But make sure that you follow the new tag, 1DV523 server dev. The 1DV525 was only for the preceding course. So we have a new tag in Slack. So just try to find that one. It looks something like... No, I will not show that. Or can I? Yeah, I could. So the discussion has already started, and please use English in this channel because it's a multi-language course. So, questions about the course as a whole concerning stuff that I've talked about? No, pretty clear. You know the drill since the last course. And we will probably dive into the content of the course then. So, first of all, server-based web programming. So, in the last course, we were on the left side in this picture. We were on the browser side and created all of our applications there. We didn't care about the web server at all, more than the web server being an address and the web server telling us stuff using the HTTP protocol, like, okay, so this was false, so this was correct. However, in this course, we will be on this side instead, on the web server side. And by being on this side, we need to think about that we don't only have one client connecting to our server. I mean, we can have thousands of clients connecting to our server, and we need to be able to handle those requests. So that's a problem we will look into. And on the web server, we will probably not do anything or everything in our applications, because we will probably be dependent of other applications. like APIs on other servers to get information, databases, or whatever. And our task in the node application is to putting it all together and sending in a response to the client. So the client will send requests to us. We will look at those requests, handle them, and send responses back to the client. That's pretty much it. A classical way of doing this is just sending back HTML views. So the client asks for a page like index.html, and we present that page to the user containing JavaScript, CSS, and stuff. But the HTML doesn't need to be static on the server. We could have done, I mean, if we look at the user, for instance, we know that the user is this user. We could do a database lookup, get data from the database, putting it into the page, and presenting the page to the user. In this course, we will not only create, this is something that we will do in the classic CRUD application, but in this course, we will not only create classic HTML, we will also create JSON, for instance, to be able to only send data to the client over, for instance, a socket or an AJAX request or whatever. Or even, I mean, the client, I think I had that question in one of the examinations in the last course, but the client doesn't always have to be the browser. The client could be other web services as well, contacting our server for data. And then we might present it with JSON data. And to be able to handle this communication well, we need to be quite familiar with HTTP protocol and how we can use HTTP protocol for our advantage in communicating with clients. So we will look at that as well. So a classical, I mean, we have had, I can't count how many different web development courses we've had since I started in 2002. And we have had a lot of different courses, like classic PHP courses, .NET courses, and Java server page. I think I actually started out using Java server pages in my first course I had. And in classical server courses, you often look at the web server doing using languages like PHP, ASP.NET, Ruby on Rails, Java. Contacting relational databases like MySQL or Microsoft's SQL Server, PostgreSQL, and sending back views to the client. However, in this course, we will do it a little bit differently. We will use Node.js on the server as well, just as we have done in the client. And instead of having a classical SQL Server, we will have something called a document-oriented database, in this case MongoDB. And those kind of databases are often put together in a package, and they are called like NoSQL servers. So just to indicate that this is not a classical SQL Server database, but the correct term for Mongo is a document-oriented database. So this is basically the stack we will be working with in this course. So this is quite neat because we know JavaScript from the client. We know JSON objects, JavaScript object notation objects being sent to from and to the server, and that's basically JavaScript. Node.js is a JavaScript implementation of a web server, so we will be handling JavaScript here as well, and handling the views in the database using JavaScript as well. So we have one language to use. In those setups, you're often, I mean, if you're writing applications for the client, you are more or less obligated to use JavaScript, even if you can use some kind of other language on top that will compile down to JavaScript. But you will have to write HTML and JavaScript. And change into the web server if you're writing PHP, then you have another language there. And then you have a third language, often called SQL, for communicating with the database. So you have a lot of different languages involved. In this case, we only have one, that's JavaScript. So Let's get on with it and dive into the Node platform. And this course is divided into learning modules. You don't need to think about it. Everything is neatly packaged on the course webpage, but this is a separate learning module, so I will have to load that one. So, Node.js, hands up, how many of you have written applications in Node.js? And I'm not counting the test applications we wrote in the last course when learning JavaScript, but have worked with Node.js. So it's no one here. Someone has tried it maybe, or worked a bit with it. Okay, great. So first of all, when we speak of Node.js, I will not say that it is a web server. Apache, for instance, is a web server. Node.js is a platform. So with Node.js, you can create web servers if you like. But Node.js is not the web server. It's a platform on the, for instance, server that we could use to create our own web servers. So you could, if you want to compare it, you can compare it to Java, the Java environment instead, because Java is not a web server, but you can create web servers using Java if you like. It's not a framework. We will be using frameworks inside of Node to get specific functionality and to be able to create web applications faster than without using a framework. We will be using Express in this course, which is probably the default decision for most starting out with Node.js. And Node.js is not just for websites. It's not just for creating websites. You can use Node in so many different ways. If you like to just script things on your computer without having web involved, you can do that. You can use Node for scripting. If you are setting up a Raspberry Pi, for instance, for some kind of home automation, could use Node on the Raspberry Pi as the platform for doing stuff with your Internet of Things in your home. I think even you can use Node in Arduino projects if you like. I think there are some kind of wrappers around Arduino if you like to use that in those kinds of applications. So it's not just a web server, it's a whole platform that you could use for many things. For instance, you might be into writing phone applications, apps for smartphones, and then you will probably need a server somewhere to be able to communicate between users, saving state and stuff. Node's perfect. You could use Node for that if you like. And we will go into pros and cons for this platform. So it was developed by Ryan Dahl. I'm not sure where he's from. We discussed it on the train, maybe from Holland. I'm not sure. So he was a math PhD student and he was getting into coding websites. And when he started using images together with Flickr, he found out that the Flickr uploading system was pretty neat, because instead of just adding files and just waiting and all the files get up at the same time, more or less, they had some kind of progress bar, so you could see how much of each file that was uploaded to the server. And this looked kind of like magic back in 2008 or something like that. So he got interested in how do they do this, and they used a technique called long polling for making this kind of functionality. But he found it interesting, and he started to create applications like that, and he wanted a platform that was suitable for writing those kinds of applications. And he started out by using C, I think, C, but that was he noticed quite soon that, okay, it's really resource efficient, but it's hard for users to implement stuff in C. So he looked for other languages, and he found that JavaScript was a really good language for doing those kinds of applications. And started looking into V8 and and the whole event-driven model of that we have seen in browsers before. And he took this model and made it to Node and running it on a server instead. So he presented his findings on a JS Conf in December of 2009. I think we've linked to this talk in to this lecture, so it could be really interesting to look at that talk. When you do, bear in mind that the code examples he's using might not be up to date. So many things have changed. So don't try to copy his code and run it, because it might not even work. But it's a good talk to see what's driven him to make this platform. He later on joined a company called Joyent, and I think Joyent is one of the actors or involved in the platform today. I mean, he started out by creating this by himself. He presented it at the conference, and other people got involved. So this became a big open source project. However, with all open source projects, not everybody have the same vision. So in this case, some people started to make a so-called fork out of this project. And the fork, you can do forks on GitHub. So if you're interested in a project, you can do a fork and you can start develop it for yourself. And if you like, you could send like updates back to the mother library, so to speak, if you like. And so that was what happened. And some people did a fork called io.js, because I think basically they thought that the development process was too slow. It didn't get forward fast enough, and they wanted to speed things up. So they broke out, and I think it was like last year, they came together again under a Node.js Foundation umbrella. So today, Node.js is, and io.js are merged. You will, if you look at version numbers, you will see in the beginning of Node, it was like 0.1.2, 0.1.3, and so on. And then finally, they made a leap to version 4 and 5 and 6. And this week, version 7 was released. So that's telling, I mean, you can see where the merge happened, because Node took a big leap in version numbers. But that's, I think that's pretty good for you, because now we have one platform to work with and not separate platforms, even though it's good it's good when we have competing platforms, because they could drive each other forward. So we will take 15 minutes break. And after the break, we will get into the philosophy behind Node.js. And we will also look at what kind of applications is suitable for using a Node.js as platform, and which applications are not. Maybe some applications should be written in Java, for instance. So let's look at that after the break. 15 minutes. So back to Node. The philosophy behind Node is to make this platform really, really small and lightweight. Compare it to other platforms where you try to incorporate as much functionality as possible. This is the total opposite. So the core of Node is more or less only the things needed to make it work. It's really, really small and lightweight. For instance, if you just start Node, you don't get a web server, or you don't get stuff like that. It's built into the core, though. So some things like web servers, working with HTTP and the file system, those are core functionality that is built into Node. But other than that, it's nothing. So everything you need on top of this is distributed to packages. We have this package management system that's called npm, that is built or bundled together with Node. So when you install Node, you will get the package manager as well. And in the package manager, you can search the community for functionality that you need. But even when it comes to writing packages for the community, the same philosophy will apply. And that is, try to make modules, packages, as small as possible to only like make packages that do one thing and one thing good, and then you bundle those packages together if you want bigger functionality. So everything is built upon simplicity and pragmatism, basically. So that's the whole philosophy behind Node. Whoa, wrong. So some characteristics of the Node platform. When we write code or write modules to Node, we should write non-blocking code, and that's really important. What is non-blocking code? Well, basically what it says, it's codes that don't block the execution. In other platforms like Apache, for instance, and PHP, if you block the main the thread, there is nothing bad happening. But in Node, we have this single-threaded environment. We have one single event loop, and if we block that loop with code, everything will stop, just as we have seen in the browser. If we block the main event loop in the browser, everything will stop executing. But when it comes to Node, it's even worse, because it's not only one user's flow that will stop executing, it's all users' interaction with the server that will be blocked. So we shall write non-blocking code when we are working with Node.js. In the same way, this is built upon asynchronous programming that you got a taste of in the last course. Since we cannot block the event queue, we need some way of just delegate things to other threads in the platform. It's an event-driven module, just like in the browser, in opposite to the threaded models in other systems. And we will have a look at that. So the blocking versus non-blocking, first of all. If we look at the upper example, this is from PHP. And this is a simple file get contents call. And what this will do is it will contact the example.com website and read the response back. And in this case, just echo it, present it on the web page. What happens in this case is that on the first row, file get contents, this thread will stop and wait. And it will wait until this call has been made and the content comes back, and then it will proceed the execution. So this is synchronous code. That's quite normal. And this works good in multi-threaded environments. But in Node, that is one thread, this is a catastrophe. What's it called? Oh, whatever. But it's not a good way of doing it, because everything will freeze. So a better way of doing it, and how we should do it in Node, is this non-blocking asynchronous way. And you are probably familiar with how it looks. So we require a request object, and the request module, and this is to be able to make requests. So not even making simple requests to another web server is built in from the beginning. You need to require it from a module. So we make a request to www.example.com, and when the request is finished, we have a callback function that will handle the response. And this function, you probably are familiar with those kind of callback functions. The first argument is the error, and the second is the response information about the response. And in this case, the third one is the body, that is the content that we got. So this looks harder to write. I mean, this is so simple. The blocking code is so simple to write. This is harder work. The first one is PHP. The second one is JavaScript. you might be able to write code like this in PHP nowadays, I'm not sure, but I mean, this is built upon the model of higher order functions, that we can send functions as parameters. I'm not sure you can do that in PHP even. So when it comes to this kind of event-driven programming that we have looked on in the last course, we, for those of you who are not up to date with it, John has recorded a lot of demos. So you have one demo that uses regular callbacks. Then we have a demo using promises instead. You are probably quite familiar with promises. Then he has recorded, I think, no, you have not, but he's written a lot about generators and promises in conjunction. So we will have, we have resources for this as well. Then we have something called event emitters, and this is, I mean, it would be nice to be able to, in an asynchronous model, to be able to send your own events and trigger your own events. And this is the event emitters, and John has recorded a video for that as well. And then we have something called the wait and async. That is it part of the JavaScript? Is it ES 2007, or is it something that is built upon JavaScript?
I think it's a part of JavaScript.
Yeah. So a wait and async is ways of making this kind of asynchronous code easier to read and easier to write. But it's quite new, and I haven't worked with, have you, John?
No.
No. So, yeah, for the future, it says. So if you like, or you get interested, you can have a look at this, but we will not touch upon it in the course. We will focus on, I would argue that I will focus mostly upon promises, but you will probably see code with the other examples as well. Event emitters will be used somehow, I think.
You could use it.
Yeah, you could use it, but I think, depends on the assignments. So, okay, we're going to look at multi-threaded versus single-threaded applications. So think of the red box as the web server, the one handling the requests. So we have three clients, A, B, and C, and we have a single-threaded web server. So we see an immediate problem with this model, because we will serve them in the order the request comes in. So the A is sending in a request, and we are handling the request and returning a response to the A. And after that, we could work with B and handling B's request, sending back an answer. So C will have to wait until all other requests are finished. And this might be okay for three clients, but three clients is quite a small number. We might be needing to handle thousands and thousands of simultaneous connections. And if we were to do that with a single-threaded environment like this, it will be super slow for more or less all clients. It will just be a long wait to get something from this server. So, not best solution for a web server. So, how did classical web servers implement this instead? Well, instead, we saw that, okay, we have threads. We could create threads for every request to the server. So if three requests are coming in, we could create three threads, and each thread is handling one request, and those could be run simultaneously. There is a problem, though. If we have file I/O, for instance, we are reading things from a hard drive. The hard drive will not be able to read maybe three things at the same time. So we will still have to wait between the threads when we are accessing I/O, doing I/O access, like databases or whatever. We might need to wait. However, of course, I mean, this could be really good implemented, and often is, so that data can be cached and we don't need to wait for a physical hard drive and things like that. But in theory, this model is, it has some problems. It has advantages as well that I will go into, but this classic model has some problems, and especially when it comes to I/O. like reading things from databases, for instance. So, but this is like the traditional web server, like an Apache web server, for instance. So let's instead look at the model we will be working with. If you are familiar with the event loop in the browser, you will have no problem understanding this in Node because it's basically the same thing. So three requests coming in. They are being processed in order which they come in. But instead of just executing the whole request, waiting for file IOs and stuff, we will use the event queue. So say that the first user wants to read a file or an image or whatever and process that image from disk. This will be done asynchronously, and we will add something to the event queue. And when this IO is being made by external threads, they will, when they are finished, when they have fetched the image, they will add to the event queue that they fetched the image, and eventually the loop will get this piece of code and run it in the main thread. Exactly the same model that you have in the browser, but in the browser, these IO things are things happening in the browser instead, like rendering the DOM or handling XML HTTP requests, for instance, or WebSockets or wherever. In this case, we have IO operations or what we need in the on the server. If you have not watched it already, please watch Philip Roberts' What the Heck is the Event Loop Anyway? His demo where he demos the event loop. It is demoed within the browser, but that doesn't matter because it's the same philosophy. It works the same way in Node, like in the browser. So if you get one model, it will work in the other environment as well. So please have a look at that if you are not familiar with the event loop. So this is a picture John has borrowed from Twitter, but he's credited anyway. It's just another representation of the Node.js system, and you will see that we have this libuv, which is a Unix, I think, project that Node.js is built upon for handling IOs and network operations and things like that. Even, I think, starting up new processes. Because even though Node is single-threaded, it's only single-threaded in the environment we are writing code. I mean, it will take advantage of all available threads when it comes to IO operations, for instance. But that is handled by the libuv. And yeah, that's important as well. I mean, the JavaScript engine in this case is V8. And that's because Google released the V8 approximately the same time as Riandahl created Node. So of course, it was a good choice to take the V8 engine and just implement it in Node. And I think it's the same, exact the same implementation of V8 in Node that it's in the client, right? They are not two separate projects. Mm-hmm. So what Node is making this Node.js bindings between the V8 and the libuv for handling IOs. Node.js is written in, I think it's written in C and C++, and I think libuv is written in C as well. So even though we are writing JavaScript code, the system, the Node system, is a C or C++ project. So if you would like to get involved in this open source project, you need to read up on your C or C++ skills. Oh well, that's basically that. So to the pros and the cons. First of all, pros, I've touched upon it. It's really, really neat to be able to write JavaScript everywhere. To have JavaScript in the client, to have JavaScript on the server, to store things using JSON, to transmit data using JSON. I think I said in the last course that if you're looking at APIs for getting data to your applications and you come over a good API that sends you XML, you will be a little bit sad because you do not want to work with XML. But if you find a JSON API, you will be happy because it's so much simpler to work with the data. Node is really, really good at handling many requests. So if we back up to this model, I mean, this multi-threaded model is good because if the first thread is locking of for a synchronous call or a calculation that is taking a lot of time, it will not affect the other threads because they are separate processes. And this is really good in a multi-threaded environment. But however, each thread has quite a lot of overhead. I think there is an article that Jan has referred to that says that each thread in I think if it's Java or if it's a Apache server, I'm not sure, but has an overhead of around 4 megabytes of internal memory. So by creating a lot of simultaneous connections, your internal memory will be run out and you will have to add more RAM to the web server, basically. So you have quite a big overhead for every thread, and the threads might even, I'm not sure how many threads you have, but it's quite a lot, but there is a limitation. However, in this model, each request has only a tiny bit of memory usage on the heap. So it will be able to handle many millions of requests, whereas this model will be able to handle thousands. So Node is really, really good for handling a lot of requests. And that comes together with the resource saving, because it's not that every request will take really a small amount of resources. And it's really good for data intensive real-time applications. I mean, applications where you have a lot of requests that will, I mean, for instance, some kind of real-time, think of the US election coming up next week, for instance. You will probably visit web pages where you will get the polls coming in real time. And I mean, how many will look at that page? Probably if New York Times or whatever, CNN, is publishing that kind of application, there will be probably millions of people just wanting data all the time. And trying to have all those million people going into a traditional web server will need that web server to be enormous. But I mean, what you are probably sending to the clients is, first of all, you're sending a client application with maybe a canvas showing real-time graphs and stuff. So you will have an initial load of an application. But then after that, the only thing that is sent between the server and the client is data. It's JSON data, small chunks of data probably, like 200 bytes or something like that. It will not be a lot of data, but it will be data quite often. And that kind of applications are really suitable for the Node environment to make that type of applications. So those are the pros. The cons: it's really not suitable for CPU intensive tasks. So think of it, if you were in this model, if your request triggers some kind of calculation, I mean, if that calculation requires a lot of CPU during a couple of seconds, you will have a problem, because every request coming in needing to use the CPU for a couple of seconds will just make this queue grow forever, and you will not be able to process all the requests eventually. So if you're building an application where you need to do bigger calculations, you could still have Node as a front, but the CPU intensive calculations, you need to delegate them somehow. Could be a Java server standing not side by side, but virtually side by side. So you just send this, you just forward this calculation to the Java server, and that will do the calculations, and it will tell you when it's finished in an asynchronous way. And when you write code, you need to think about this as well, so that you don't write blocking code or code that will take a lot of iterations or do stuff that is CPU intensive. It's a harder programming model. You've seen it already. It's harder to program asynchronous than just classic synchronous. Yeah, so the question is, will we do something like that in this course, interaction with other servers and stuff? Well, you will do interaction with other servers. I don't think we will do any data, CPU intensive calculations, but you will get the tools. Will we look at workers in Node?
No.
So, yeah. But I mean, it's the main thing is that you are important, that you are informed about the problem, because then you know that, okay, I need to do some kind of heavy calculations, then Node is not the way to go. So you have two options: either we do this in a totally different server environment altogether, or we use Node as the front and just delegate it to another server. And doing that, I mean, you will work with HTTP, for instance. So I mean, if that server has an API, you can just call that API and get a response back. We will look at that, those types of applications in the course. It's a new platform. PHP, when was it introduced? It was like in an Apache in the mid-90s, something like that. I mean, Ryan Dahl released this in 2009, and it's quite a new platform, so it's not that mature yet. And I mean, you will see posts about where people say that you should not use Node, for instance, in production, because there are so many problems with the platform still. And however, you will also see that many big actors has implemented Node for many of their parts of their platforms. I think, John, or do we have a picture on which projects that are using Node? But I know Netflix changed from Java to Node on many levels last year. I think PayPal is using Node as well. So, yeah. But it's not a silver bullet. You cannot use Node for everything. It's not suitable for everything, and you need to know that in some cases a Java server is better. In some cases a classic Apache server is better. In some cases, a Node server or platform is the best choice. So just something to look out for. In this first example, the first one, we have some kind of sort user operation that needs to be done. So we are just using the regular users.sort. However, the sort method, it's not asynchronous. The sort method is synchronous. So it takes a callback, it takes a function as a parameter, but it's not a callback function, because the function that is taken as a parameter is a function used to be able to determine how to sort this array. So this is a synchronous function, sort, and if you have a lot of users and you run this sort, it might take quite a lot of CPU cycles. So beware, if you have large data sets, you might need some kind of other types of functions or make those the sort function asynchronous. Maybe you should divide this into chunks so that you use timeouts, for instance, to divide so that you don't hog this event queue, that you could divide your work, or you use some kind of worker process like we do in the browser. use a worker process to do the sort and send you the result back when it's finished. Same thing with, I mean, this is something that is you might not think about it, but when you do a JSON parse, for instance, if you get data from another server and you do a JSON parse to parse this text into JSON objects or JavaScript objects, JSON parse is synchronous. It's not an asynchronous function. And if you have a really big JSON set of JSON data, if you have a big string, this could take a while as well. So you need to think about your code in a way that what is synchronous and what is asynchronous? And is it a risk that this piece of code will block the queue? You always need to have that in mind when you're coding for Node. Of course, you have a lot of profilers and stuff that could analyze your code, find the bottlenecks like you have in the browser. I haven't used that a lot, so I can't recommend any. But John, you said something that maybe in the newest version of the Node platform they have increased. They have done a lot of effort of debugging and things like that in the platform, and maybe they have looked more at profiling as well. But I'm not sure about that because it was just released. So. NPM does not stand for Node Package Manager. It's just a package manager for Node. But I think it was called Node Package Manager back in the days. And then they just said that, okay, we just call it the package manager and we doesn't specify that it is for Node only. But it is a package manager for Node and it's included when you install Node. So, and I mean, the core of Node was small, so you need to be able to extend and add functionality. And the NPM is the solution for that. They have a simple web page. You can go in and search for modules, and then you can just include those modules into your projects really, really easy. It's a command line interface program, so you will use the npm install command to install new modules. So if you want the module, you look it up on the web and you find a module suitable. You find out what it's the name of the module and then you just add the name after npm install and it will install this module. But we will look of different ways of doing that. Yep. Come again.
Will we use npm
module packages in this course? Definitely yes, you will. Because, as I said, otherwise you have nothing more or less. So you will have to add packages. If you looked in the package JSON file in the preceding course, you saw that there was a lot of packages installed. We used Mocha for did we? No, we did not. Another course, but we use Browserify, for instance. That is a Node package manager, an npm module. So let's have a look at the package.json. We had it in the client, or not in the client, but we had it in the projects in the last course for doing build scripts and things like that. And the package.json is like the configuration of your Node projects. So this is just a JSON file where you add certain keywords and those keywords can trigger things to happen. It can trigger things when you are running the application on your local computer, and it could trigger other things to happen when you're trying to add this to a production environment. So you could have directives in this file that says that, okay, in production you should use this and that. And in development, we should use a different set of tools because we need debugging, for instance. So just have a look at this. You can add your name and the version of this project that we are writing or this module we are writing. We have a description. The main says which is the starting point of this module, index.js, or I would prefer app.js. We have scripts, so we could add scripts to this file that will run behaviors. When we, for instance, write npm run test, we want some test libraries to execute and validate our project. In this case, it's just echoing arrow no test specified, but we could add the scripts for running the tests here. We have some keywords, and those keywords are important if you are publishing your module on the npm library, because those are searchable. We have information about the author of this module, which license is being used, and then we have dependencies. So when you are writing a module, you will probably have dependencies. You will depend on other modules because the core is so small. And then you add those dependencies here. So in this case, we are using Lodash, that is a library for handling arrays and objects and working with strings, for instance, commonly used. So we are saying, okay, if we need Lodash for this code to run. And we need at least version 3.10, I think that will say, or a compatible version of that version of Lodash. You can specify, using this first character, you can specify ranges, and you can specify that you will always have the latest version, for instance, or you could specify a specific version if you remove the roof. And I mean, in a production environment, you would probably need to specify the versions really, really strict, because you do not want to risk that a new version of a module will break your code, because other ones are writing those modules. They could try to guarantee that it will be backward compatible, but you will not know that until you test and run your code. So I would recommend, or many recommend, that you always use one specific version, or in this case, a compatible version. You should not go with the latest one if you're not just doing experiments. And that's dependencies. That's the modules needed to run this application or this module. Then we have dev dependencies. And dev dependencies are dependencies that you need to be able to develop this module. So here we could have, like, in this case, Mocha. That is a testing framework. So when we are developing, we are needing the testing framework. But in production, we should not include the testing framework on the production server, because, I mean, that could open up for security vulnerabilities, for instance. So dependencies are modules needed to run the code in production, and dev dependencies are modules needed during development. Yeah.
So if you add, like, one dependency in your JSON project, does Node handle all the caching stuff, or are they already installed locally, or will it get it from the server?
Yeah, I will get to that now, I think. So the question is, if you're adding those, are they being magically installed, or are they already installed, or how will this work? Well, great. Segue to this one. So, for instance, you could, I mean, if you just do an npm install Mocha like this, you could start up a Node project and you just write npm install Mocha. What will happen is that it will take this Mocha module and install it inside of your module in a folder called node underscore modules. But however, if you just do that, and then someone else is forking your GitHub repo and trying to start this project, they also, you need some kind of instructions telling them that, oh, you need to install Mocha to be able to work with this. And that's not a good way, being that you need to document all the modules for the user to install. So a better way is adding those --- save to when you're installing Mocha. What this will do is it will edit the package.json and add this version of Mocha to the package.json file. So it will basically create this line, those lines, or this line of code. for you. So you do not need to do that. However, if you do --save, it will be a dependency. If you add --save --dev, it will be a dev dependency. And Mocha is probably a dev dependency in this case. So by doing this, you are like building your packet.json to be compatible with your module. So everything should be documented in the package.json. So when another person will fork your code, download it, it will not have those modules installed, because adding all those modules to the GitHub repo will be, I mean, that's a lot of code that you are not handling in this project. So you do not want to check this code into GitHub. So you will probably use your gitignore file to just ignore this node modules altogether. So when another person downloads the project, it will only be the package.json. It will be the application files. So if they just try to run app.js, you will get a lot of errors, just saying, oh, can't find module, blah, 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 blah. What they need to do is just write npm install. And I think you've done that in the last course, or we did it for you. But by running npm install, this package.json will be parsed, and all dependencies will be installed. And they will be installed in the node underscore modules folder. However, look at this, the last line. It says npm install Mocha globally. So you can do that. You can install packages globally on your computer. So if you know that in all my projects, I always use JSHint, for instance, then you can install JSHint globally. So it does not need to be installed for each and every project you have. However, it should still be in the package.json. And you can't add it, say that it should be global in the package.json, because that would be not too nice to your users if you could, because then it would install things globally on their computer that they don't like. So everything in the package.json is installed inside of your module. And when you do this, when you install Mocha, if you have a look when you install, you will see that Mocha, in its case, has a lot of dependencies. And each of those dependencies have dependencies and dependencies. So if you've ever installed Linux or used Linux, you know the drill. You know that it's a really small core, but if you try to install something, you will get a lot of packages installed. And it's the same philosophy with Node. So just by installing Mocha, you will probably get a lot of different other dependencies installed as well. And this means that, I mean, this node modules, you could always delete it. Just delete the folder and do an npm install, and it will reinstall everything for you. And that's a good test for assignments as well. So what we are doing in the assignments is that we are downloading your source code, and then we are doing an npm install. And if you have not updated your package.json, your project will not run in our environment. So please, when you're finished, try to just install or download the repository to another directory and try to run it from there. Could be that it works still if you have a lot of modules installed globally, but yeah. Yeah, you don't need to think about those. So if you have a look in, I think, if we look at the picture, you see in our application, we got a node module, and we said that Lodash was a dev dependency. No, a dependency, and Mocha was a dev dependency. So if we look inside of Mocha, we will see that has a package.json as well. And if you look in the package.json, you will see what dependencies Mocha have. And you will see that Mocha has those dependencies, command, debug, diff, and you could go on and go on and go on. So this will recursively install itself. You don't need to think about it more than the first level. That is your dependencies.
So in your package.json, you only it will automatically specify two dependencies, Lodash and Dash. But in this Mocha, it contains a lot of dependencies.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly like that. So we only have two dependencies. We have Lodash and Mocha, and those have their own dependencies, but we don't need to think about that. Well, in production, maybe if you're right, if you have a high end, I mean, if you're a big company writing applications with Node that is critical applications, you probably would like to know what Lodash actually does and what dependencies Lodash have. You might need to do your homework, so to speak, to know what your code base actually is running. I mean, this is the weak point of this model. I mean, you do not know if Lodash have a bad module somewhere that is exposing your application, for instance. So, and actually, this was a real case, I think, in March of this year. A user, I don't remember his name, but a big committer to NPM. He had over 250 modules on NPM. Kik, I think it's a chat application or something. Kik, K-I-K, yeah. So K-I-K wanted to start releasing modules on NPM. And then they found out that he had a module called K-I-K. So their lawyers contacted NPM and asked NPM to remove this user's modules or rename them or whatever because they are Kik. And they contacted him and said you should remove it or something like that in a clumsy way. They weren't really smooth about it. So he just went completely bad. Fuck this, sorry Americans. But so he just removed all of his modules. All 250. And among those, there was one module called LeftPad that like removed spaces to the left in a string. Some quite a simple thing to do. I think it was like 8 lines of code. But it turns out that a lot of other modules used this LeftPad module. So things like, do you remember Babel and big libraries just fell because the module wasn't there anymore, so you couldn't install those anymore. So that's the weak point of this system. I think they have had a lot of discussions around this since then, and the policy about how to be able to remove and things like that. So it's triggered a discussion. But you should know that, I mean, it's a really neat model because it brings out the good in the world, so to speak, that we could take, I mean, everybody could do their share, but it comes with a disadvantage, and that is security and vulnerability to this kind of accidents. And you told me on the train that Facebook, I think it was, has started their own package manager project called Yarn. That might be something that we will use in the future. That maybe addresses those kinds of problems, but in a more with big actors like Google and Facebook and stuff involved. Not sure what will happen, but be aware, if you're doing this in big production systems, you will probably need to know what dependencies you have and what dependencies those have. If you are running Windows and using Vagrant together with VirtualBox, you could run into a problem with symbolic links. So some modules that you will install will need to have some kind of binaries in another location, and they will call those binaries by using symbolic links, which are not handled in Windows. So your the shared code between the Vagrant machine or VirtualBox machine and your local Windows environment will not be able to handle those libraries or modules, and you will get errors. So it might be that the same Vagrant machine on your MacBook or friend's MacBook on the other side of you will work and your in Windows will not. Then you could use this --no bin links when you install modules, and they will create those modules, install them without those symbolic links. We had a really tough time with this last year in Kalmar. I'm not sure, might be solved in newer versions of VirtualBox, maybe. I'm not sure. Well, oh, I have more. Yeah, so when you're working with, I mean, when you start to code and you're working with those modules, you just require the module name. So if we want to work with Mocha or Lodash, we will just write Lodash in the same way that we did when we installed it, the same name. So don't use a dot slash before. Dot slash is for your own modules, like on the second row that you did in the last course. You could include your own modules, of course, on a local path. You have some modules that are built into the core. There are not many, but there are some. FS, for instance, file system, is built in. So if you have worked with, like, I think it's POSIX, the standard is with Unix systems and Linux system, if you're familiar with those modules you have in POSIX, you will recognize those modules as well, because they have tried to mimic those as much as possible. Yeah, and they are cached and stuff. But you can read more about modules on this web page. Last year, ECMAScript 2015 or ECMAScript 6 was released, and there is today a really good support in Node for ECMAScript. The good thing here is that you do not have to worry about different browsers, because now we're on the server and we can control the environment. So if you have the latest version of Node, you could use the latest features as well without worrying. So you will probably find out that, I mean, all those things like arrow functions, promises, generator functions, they are included in the platform. You said something like the version 7 had like 95% of the standard implemented, or more even. So if it's in the standard, you will probably find it in Node as well. But not everything, and newer technologies are not included as well. The one thing to note as well is that, I mean, the browser and the Node is two different environments. You will find some similarities between them, like both are using event queues, both are using JavaScript as the language, but the APIs are completely different. The APIs you have in the browser are not the same as you have on the server. So if you are trying to contact another server, for instance, in Node, you cannot use the XML HTTP request object because it's not part of Node. It's part of the web browser APIs. However, most APIs in Node are trying to mimic APIs from the browser. So if you're writing set timeout, for instance, or set interval, you will see that those APIs are included in Node as well, because they have taken the name and implementation from the browser and implemented those in Node as well. However, if you really, really love using the XML HTTP request in browser, you will probably, if you Google on MPN, you will probably find a module that is mimicking the browser module, if you really like to work with that one, but you will probably find better ones as well. So be aware that the APIs you have in the browser are not the same in Node. Those are two different environments, and the event loop and everything around that is borrowed and the same. The V8 is the same, JavaScript is the same, but not the APIs. Okay, until next time. I'm not sure when next time is, but might be next week, I guess, that we will have a lecture. But to the next time, you'll start reading the learning object. John has done a really good job in writing about Node as a platform, as about MPN and the event-driven programming in Node. So you will find quite a good course literature material on the webpage that you could use as a complement to the lectures. Please have a look at those. Also have a look at the videos, the demos that John has recorded for repeating asynchronous programming. With the other course in mind, you will probably feel that, oh, this is familiar. I know this already. And that's quite a good feeling to have in the beginning of the course, that not everything is new. start the exercises. There will be exercises in this course. You will get the repository during the week where you can have your code securely stored in our organization on GitHub, or you can use your own GitHub account for the exercises if you like. However, the examination assignment must be placed in our repositories. And it will soon be out. So start reading up. Okay. Will there be video demos like previous course? I think there are in some cases. Not everyone. Yeah, but in some cases. Okay, thanks for today.